from his surrounding, just like any
Yes.
other normal person. And
Exactly.
the cinematographer or the visual storyteller, gradually
Yes.
my plan is to move from visual storyteller to specifically a cinematographer with
Yes.
as the question,
Yes.
I mean, as the discussion goes on.
Goes on.
So another thing which I'd like to know, we would like
Yes.
to know from him,
Yes.
is the cinematographer, and primarily the cinematographer, not any other visual storyteller, the
Yes.
cinematographer receives input from 5 sensory organs.
Yes.
Yeah, Sunny sir is here.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you. I am hearing you for a long time.
Okay.
Good morning. Good morning, sir.
Good morning. Good morning. Very good morning to all.
Yeah, Shobhoshachi. Shobhoshachi can introduce. Yeah.
Yes, introduce sir. I am Shobhoshachi Banerjee. Sir, I studied electronic cinematography in FTII.
Which
and
year?
Now, sir, 2006-2007. I graduated in 2007.
Okay.
And sir, then I have worked and now I teach. I never had the good fortune to be taught by you, but one thing that I really loved was one of my student was taught, like, was your student in Revati Kala Mandir.
Okay.
Souvik Barman.
Ah, Souvik Barman. He is now, I think, doing good.
Yes, he's working. Yes, sir. He's doing. Yes.
Yeah, I think I also met Souvik. I mean, he met me 2 years ago, 2 or 3 years ago.
Yes, Souvik is my student.
Okay. So it is a small world. We are all connected.
Yes, sir. Yeah. Yes.
I hope check how many the students are here. Sound and visual I have made.
Yeah, it's perfect.
And lighting all done.
Tamal, are you there?
Yes, I'm there.
How many more students?
The sessions. Okay. I 37 registration we got last time. So I have sent the link as well.
Okay.
So, sometimes they will join. You can start the sessions.
Let me see how many students are here right now. 11 students.
15 students.
No, participants are showing us also. So participants means we 4 are also included.
Right.
So yeah, 11 students, and definitely the number is going to increase in the next 15 minutes or so. I've seen that in the last 2 webinars. So let's welcome Sunny sir. Sunny Joseph, ISC. He's also the president of Indian Society of Cinematographers. Sunny sir has been working in film industry, and I should say Indian film industry, for the last from 83 onwards. That so makes
almost
it almost 40 years.
40 years, yes.
Almost 40 years, 37 years.
Yes, 37 years.
Yeah.
I think sir is back. Sunny sir is back.
Sir is back, yeah. And he has shot films in practically all major Indian languages. 55 feature films, quite a few documentaries, and many TV serials. He is also a director. At the time when he was in Film Institute of India, FTI, Film and Television Institute of India, he directed his own film. He directed a short film as part of his diploma. And he got a national award for that. It's called The Clown and the Dog, and it's available on YouTube. And from time to time, he directed TV series or documentaries. And obviously, he wants to direct a feature film soon. And he has worked with a lot of different directors from across India. He has worked in 5 or 6 major works in Calcutta, in Bengali and Hindi, with Buddhadev Bhattacharya, Buddhadev Dasgupta, and Sohini Dasgupta, and Malaya Bhattacharya.
Malaya Bhattacharya.
How many films in Bengali, including documentary? I think the Calcutta University documentary was in English.
That was a lengthy film, three and a half, 4 hours long.
Oh, So was that in Bengali or?
It was in Bengali and English, I think.
I mean, interviews must be in Bengali, some of the interviews.
Yeah.
And how many fiction films in Bengali did you shoot?
Four.
Right. I mean, including Shohini's.
That will be five.
That is so Hindi. That will be five. Yes, that,
yes. Shohini's is in Hindi. I haven't
Hindi,
seen
that. Yeah, I have seen that film. Yes, that's in Hindi.
Okay. So we'll talk about that. We'll talk about your experience in Calcutta. And Sani sir has worked with, some of the major filmmakers around the world. He got inspired by them. The name which comes to mind readily is Christoph Zanussi. He was in his film set. Life is a sexually transmitted disease, right?
As a student.
Yeah, and he's connected globally with other major filmmakers, with inspiration from them, exchanges thoughts. And we'll learn from him how he uses inputs from other areas in life, how he gets inspired from reading and looking at other works of art and creates his own style. Okay, welcome, sir, again. Welcome again.
Welcome.
Namaste.
The first question.
One second. Before, let me tell to all my listeners and viewers that the power situation in the place where I am staying now, it is a remote place in Kerala, a hilly area with a lot of rubber plantations. So there may be any moment the power may go. In a day, it is 4 or 5 times it happens. So bear with me. It mostly comes back within 1 or 2 minutes. So I will be back. And if it is going to be prolonged, and then I will come out to my garden and switch on the mobile. And I will come through the mobile phone. Anyway, warm welcome to the session.
You are at Kottayam right now.
Yeah, in Kottayam. Near Kottayam. It is further near away.
Okay. Let me start the session with a formal question. And from there, we can move freely. Yeah. We can have a free flow. In visual storytelling, everything takes place inside the frame. The frame is our playing ground.
Yeah.
How does the frame affect the storytelling and in turn the story? How do the aspect ratio, that is the shape of the frame, and the size of the frame influence the filmmaker's decision?
And also the narrative.
Yeah.
No, this is a very long history on this question from the time of other visual arts painting or photography. And in fact, in the early days, when Sergei Eisenstein, when Sergei Eisenstein wanted to propose a ideal frame for the cinema, he actually proposed a 1:1 ratio. He said the square format will be the best suited to cinema. Probably there is a reason. And if you look at our own image in this broadcast, it will be almost half of the frame. If you cut, it will be almost a square. Eisenstein's time onwards, this debate is very much there. And as I said early, he proposed a square format. And obviously there was a idea of aspect ratios and proportions were discussed from the time of Greek philosophers and golden ratio and golden proportion and all those kind of ideas were in circulation. But I think that probably Eisenstein suggested the square format because that is best suited for a human face. So it will be a close-up of a face like this will be best suited in a square format. It will be filling the frame fully and the negative space will be very less. So that is a great idea. And probably, there was, we are used to it, like, the old records covers is 1:1. And very recently, Instagram, when it started, their preferred aspect ratio was 1:1. So many of the youngsters are used to taking photographs in 1:1 ratio. And very recently, even in films, this ratio is coming up. So this is a, obviously we can say that a rectangular frame is considered proper or ideal in terms of when you think about beauty and in proportion of a golden ratio. And that has stayed into the cinema from photography and earlier in paintings. And currently when we discuss about the aspect ratios or the frame shape or frame size of current practices, now we know that the image which you are seeing now is 16:9, almost 2:1. And which is Univision, which is 2:1, which great Storaro, Vittorio Storaro has proposed that 2:1 is the best aspect ratio for the films. And he himself has been practicing. His films were, especially with Carlos Sara and all, he has made it in like Goya or Tango, all made in 2:1 aspect ratio. So, there is an interesting factor in the concept of space measurement in Japanese society or culture. It is called tatami. It is the floor mat, size of the floor mat and its arrangement in different measures. And tatami is almost like it's all square, 1:1. And that probably 2:1 is 2 squares. So 16:9 is somewhere closer to it. But if you think of it, apart from Europe and America, the widely popular format in India and China, other Asian countries are anamorphic. That is 2.35:1. Which is almost like 2 golden ratios roughly put together. And in fact, there is a Eastern magic rectangle, which was supposed to be having magical properties, which is almost like our CinemaScope frame, So this question, when we consider about, this aspect ratio, the idea, the predominant idea we should be considering is that how much the positive space and negative space is created in relation to the actor's body. So in a horizontal aspect ratio like a CinemaScope frame, when you have a face at one side of the frame or center of the frame, you have a very vast expanse of negative space around the character. So then you will have to fill it with or keep it like that or fill it with lot of other elements. So in a way, 4:3, if you look at the old silent look at a film like Passion of Joan of Arc. that face, Falconetti's face as Joan is so intense and heavily, like a magical image. It is there and it's imprinted because of the, that aspect ratio. I prefer to think like that. And, I can tell you an example of how we finally get into deciding this, aspect ratio. So one is like when once I was going to visit the location for Sanabi, the Aribam Shyam Sharma's film, and Sanabi was shot in a village, and there was this. I was those days I was very fascinated with 1.85, the wide aspect ratio within the 35mm format. So I wanted to use that, but then the idea of Aribam Shyam Sharma, his philosophy of looking at the character, the environment as a holistic body has to, the problem, let me just illustrate it with the problem. See, suppose there is a sequence of a tea shop and there are a few benches outside under a tree. A tree is very high. And then you will see a mountain behind the this area, background. So the people are, two persons are sitting in the bench. You can see the inside of the tea shop. And then as soft as need of his shot, I need to see the mountain, the tree, and the person, and the tea shop. So if I keep a 1.85 format, then to get it all together, I will need to go back. Whatever lens I am using, I will be going back. But if it is the 4:3 aspect ratio, which has more space taken in the top and bottom, my tree can be safely included without sacrificing on the size of the human figure in the foreground. So such kind of considerations are there sometimes. And obviously, if you are making a mainstream commercial film, the first consideration is distribution. And that itself will dictate to you to be, shooting on CinemaScope. So there are other things like that. Obviously, the frame is the most important window where you show the, three-dimensional world. Remember, whether your mobile screen or a laptop screen, or the screen in the theater is a two-dimensional area on which you project these images, replicating the three-dimensional world we experience. So to create that three-dimensionality of the world, obviously in painting, they have created, Western art created perspective from the time of Leonardo da Vinci, and it was developed into a great tool to explain this foreground, middle ground, and background, and to place your lens in such a way that you give importance to some objects or character in front of the lens. Some things are left behind, in the background. Some are equally placed to balance, and all these balancing and everything comes when you consider the frame. So the frame, edge of the frame, or the frame lines, which is the definition of the screen space, itself is very important, and where you place it, in which area, which all these kind of considerations comes into effect when you start talking of frame. Even in this frame, yesterday we were testing, and this left side of my wall was completely blank, and it was not well balanced. So I said to Anirban, today I will create a, I will put a poster there so that we get a well balanced image of mine. So this, you go on observing the screen space, which is through your viewfinder, and move it left, right, up, down, rearrange all the elements and in terms of nearness to the camera, and rearrange in terms of its affinity and contrast. That that is the two basic principles with which filmmakers or a visual artist work, and that is something we would, I would like to talk to also. And probably, you know, just if I go on discussing, talking about it, and it will be going on. So probably, if there is anything to ask, Anirban, you can.
This leads to the next question, which is related. You already talked about creating contrast. So yeah, we know, and you already talked about the different grounds in which filmmakers, cinematographers separate the frame, foreground, middle ground, and background. And that's a Western construct, the geometrical perspective. So we know that this came to exist to, because of the urge to create depth, to create three-dimensionality inside a two-dimensional plane. And another anthropocentric point, making the human character most important, was related to this. We know that visual storytellers draw attention to a particular character or property, but usually a character, using certain psychological tools, psychological ways of attraction. We get attracted to a character if that character is big on size in screen. That means nearness to camera, or brightest, or we get attracted by things which are moving, or suddenly if a human appears in otherwise inanimate world of a frame filled with inanimate objects, immediately our attention switches to the human, or even if it's an animal, to the animal. So using these tropes or these tools, the classical storytellers, my question is, are there other ways of visual storytelling? And as a cinematographer, as a visual storyteller, do you think that it's always good, always the correct thing to create a selective appearance, to always take the attraction to a particular character in a way that the character stands out in the crowd, the character or property, whatever it is?
Yeah, no, I understand the question. And if that, this question itself, we may take
is
1 year.
Class, but you can take one or two points. And
No. Let me come.
My question is basically this. That's what they do by creating different types of contrast between figure and ground, or between characters and other characters. So how do you play with contrast?
So before you start, I just want to add one more small question with Anirban's question. So that, since you were talking about Sanabi, you were talking about Arigam Shyam Sharma's film. So like, I would also like to add a little bit about the cultural context also. Like when you are shooting for Arigam Shyam Sharma and when you are shooting for a Malayali film or some other language, how much that also comes into your entire frame and the visual storytelling?
No, I'm, you know, first of all, let me just, all our decisions on framing, lensing, and the total mise-en-scene, I know it is primarily director's responsibility, but we cinematographers assist the director quite a lot. And in terms of I would, in terms of independent authority, I would say the cinematographer can take credit primarily for lighting and the final textural image, image testers, which is created, and as a and that palette in which the images are created, that is credit goes to the cinematographer. But in terms of lensing, volume of the figures and all that, it should come from the director ideally. Anyway, while I am talking about the other language films I have done, in Manipur or Bengal, when I come and work in different cultures, there is not much time to imbibe that very unique things. Like Sanabi, I reached there 3 days ago. So in 3 days, what I am seeing and listening and some of the cultural experiences I have of Manipuri theater, Manipuri dance or music, all that is that you rely on, and you are guided by the director. Of course, when you look at a new space, new village, space, when you are there, you see it in terms of I would say that what I try always is to bring out the suchness of things. That is the Saba. It's a Japanese idea of Saba. That is the suchness of things, whether it is an object, a tree, or a human being. And what I attempt is to bring out the Saba in it. That is the suchness of thing. That is, in another way, you can say that it is an imprint of time. So there is a...
But I have a question here.
Yeah.
Do you think this suchness of thing is universal or is it culturally coded?
Suchness of things is universal, and it is not just in object also. It can be, you can say the there is a suchness of emotion, Saba of emotion, and that is the truth in it. So you can, in a different way, you can say that you are looking for the truth in things and emotions and in events, and trying to reproduce it. Not necessarily that need not be realistic. There could be events which are not realistic or surrealistic or visionary or futuristic, but that should be a truth in it, and that will connect with the audience. And whatever you are doing, you are trying to transfer a kind of emotional response to the audience through your images and sounds. So unless that emotional connection is created through your images and sounds, no film will be enjoyable. So not necessarily the viewer consciously be aware of it, it need not be. But there is a certain way of making that intended emotion transferred to the audience. And that is the transaction which happens between the screen and the audience. That is where a film becomes successful. So like, I am obviously, when I thought of giving a frame for the webinar, I had all the possibility of placing this mobile camera up, down, or near to my main laptop screen or things like that. But I thought, let me take this corner of the frame, corner of the house, as one background, and where I can see a bit of the wall, and that obviously I kept a light here, and so my face is clearly seen. But there's, you see the longitudinal perspective lines are falling behind my head, and it is inside the frame. This frame makes a like that, it goes, the vanishing point is created behind me, even this side from top. So all that makes an interesting, you know, and the placement of myself is just over that, these vanishing points. So that becomes a, you know, a more important place to place yourself, or the important character or object, you know, you can, like that, you know, the perspective lines are used to, you know, this longitudinal planes are created, and perspective is created to bring in the three-dimensional existence of the natural world. Thereby, you know, like we said earlier, it is anthropocentric. You know, man was the most important element in nature, and he had to be seen as the omnipresent next to God. So he places the painter or the photographer places man in the center of things, and everything else becomes subsidiary. So, but Eastern pictorial traditions, Indian miniature paintings or cave paintings or Chinese scroll paintings and other Asian cultures does not have perspective, because here we had a philosophical approach to the nature and the human beings in a complementary connected way, so that everything was placed in one organic whole. So that brought the kind of pictorial rules of miniature paintings and all. Everywhere, you know, everything is equal. And this is something which I am working on now, as one of my pet subjects is the tyranny of perspective. Eastern tradition does not have perspective, and we work against it. And there are only two filmmakers in my understanding who have tried to break the tyranny of perspective. They are Yasuhiro Ozu, Japanese director, and Paranjino, the Russian filmmaker. Ozu created this, broke away with the idea of perspective and vanishing point by creating, he arranges. If you study his compositions, you can see it that all he creates a frontal plane by making his parallel vertical lines parallel, and possibly horizontal lines also parallel. And definitely his vertical lines will be always parallel in his composition, and he tried to avoid the longitudinal plane. So in that way, he creates a certain kind of harmony between the background, even with a out of focus cloth hanging in the background and the main character sitting in the foreground, all of them has equal validity in the frame. So he doesn't try to bring a foreground or a importance to the main character or things like that. He is in his environment, within his frame, everything exists correlated and with equal magnanimity and importance. So that is a certain kind of vision of life, and as also to do with their own culture and the way one comes up with the idea of the world around us. So he brings the height of the frame, the camera, to a certain level, which allows him to place his verticals in parallel and such arrangements. And that lower level of his camera position is for this breaking of the tyranny of perspective. That is what my finding, and that is what I propose. More than the Japanese cultural traits or the way the camera placed is to do this important aspect of framing. And but in case of Paranjino, he achieves this by making the objects or characters placed at different levels. if you look at his frame, you can see that his characters are placed in different heights, and then that also kind of destroys the idea of perspective. So these are the two directors which comes to my mind when I talk about the idea of perspective, when foreground, to creating foreground, background, and the middle grounds, you know. Many filmmakers and film students these days are also trying to break away the tyranny of perspective and create some very interesting compositions without the use of perspective, in a very frontal plane, and but that is interesting. And I've been telling film students that this is one of the challenges a Eastern cinematographer has to think of, how to get free of perspective lines.
Sir, I just wanted to have one question, sir, in the context of what you said about Ozu and Parathuna. Yeah. So, like, there is one film which comes to my mind, and I just am very curious to know how you look at it, is that Manikal's Uski Roti.
Yeah.
Where there is also this, taking away a bit of, perspective and using Rajasthani miniatures as a reference. How do you look at it, sir? Like, this was just my personal question. Yeah. I had a query.
No. This is what you said is right. In India, if you can think of someone who has tried this, is obviously Manikaul, and then probably in Kumar Shaini in one or two of his films. These two people have tried this kind of compositions, and even in Uski Roti, Mahajan's compositions, some of those compositions are like that. So there is a tradition which is already there, and probably let me just try to take a pictorial reference. Just a minute.
Yeah, an example would be better.
But in terms of if you take any frame from Osu, it is very evident, and I am wanting to show that. Yeah, let me just. This is again from this. No, I'm just coming to the idea of contrast. Back to, I will pick up the Osu thing in between, and then show that also. For the time being, let me connect with the idea of contrast with Anirban was saying. And so, see, we all know that if you have a blackboard, you need a white chalk, or if you have a whiteboard, you need a black pen to write and to be seen. It is very evident. But of course, our computers are also working in the principle of presence and absence, or zero and one. This is basic for any kind of coherent understanding of things. And probably that is why the eye, it's so much contrast built in, that is the first thing you will notice from any distance. So the eye becomes very prominent. You can see another eye there. So that is why you can see an emotional response. Even a person standing 10 feet away from you, you will be easily identifiable, the emotion which is expressed in the eye, because of the contrast, that black and white. And we Indians make it more attractive or important by using kajal and making it more contrasty. So anyway, the light itself, if you think of the basic component of film art, which is light, And obviously the screen is full of light and shadow. It is a dance of light and shadow, like Rumi said. It's a dance of love, actually, of light and shadow. And it is very interesting for me that light, if I ask a question, how much it takes a photon once it is produced in sun's core to come to us, to early morning sunlight, how many years? Are you hearing me?
Yes, sir.
So how many years it takes, how much time it takes for the photon which is created inside sun to come to us? Anybody? Any guess? Any guess? Somebody, sir, just shout.
Can you kick?
Hello?
A minute.
Someone was speaking something. Yes.
I think it's 8 minutes.
8 minutes, that is from surface of sun to earth, 7.5, near 8 minutes. But I am asking, a photon is created inside the core of sun, and how much time it takes it to come out of it? Anyway, 1 lakh year. So it takes 1 lakh year for the photon to come out of it. So the light which you see is already 1 lakh years old. So in a way, the past is coexisting with the present, you know, where you are. And you know, these are things which will make you wonder and what is it that you eat, whether it is a cucumber or a meat, what is it? That is also light. photosynthesis and the energy which is created thus by photosynthesis transferred to cucumber or fat, and that's what we are eating. Actually, energy is coming from the light only. So exactly same way, your sensor is receiving the energy from the photon, photons, and translating it into electrical energy and creating an image representing the natural world. So all that we eat and enjoy and seen as in cinema theater as light and shadow is all part of play of light. And we can say without doubt that if there is a God for us, it is sun, actually. Without sun, we don't exist. So light, in a sense, is our food for our body and also food for our thoughts. And when I come back to the contrast, idea of contrast, light and shadow creates a kind of, if you take a single idea of a ball, it's a kind of gray ball, or you take this kind of a thing, and the light which falls will create. If that light is not there, obviously it is a black screen. There won't be nothing, and one light actually creates this three-dimensional sphere or the ball visible to us. That light was from the camera position, obviously you will see it as only as a circular disc, not as a three-dimensional ball. It is primary. It is all primary thing. And if I move to this image, it is also a famous image. People are familiar with it, of Raghu Roy. So now you see that we have a face, almost buried child in the Bhopal tragedy time, and it became an iconic image of such tragedies all around the world. What is it that make this that iconic image? Obviously, we are seeing a play of light and shadow, thereby you know creating different tonalities within the frame, and there is shapes of the stones of the hand of the face, and there is a play of contrast. And let me tell you the two of the fundamental idea with which any creative artist or visual artist working is called affinity and contrast. You can, you know, if you see any, you know, like if you look at this image, anything adjusted, it's a large grayscale from black to white. And obviously this is not compartmentalized like this in nature, but it is a continuous varying degrees of grays. But for understanding, we
it is like a musical scale also, right?
Yeah,
I mean, in musical scale also, it's not staccato like this. It's not sharply divided.
Yes. Subrata Dada, in fact, when teaching sound system, he used to say the middle gray, which is the standard for all photographic calculation, as ma, madhyam. So he used to describe the sound system in musical notation. Sa ri ga ma pa da ni. And then, ma is the madhyam, and that is the middle tone, which is, anyway, I will just the idea that any adjacent tonalities which is present here will be affinity. So if it is black and white alone within the frame, that means it is contrast. So as you increase the contrast within, we are talking now only about the tonalities. So if you increase the contrast between, that means you are using black or white within the frame, and that is a higher intensity. So we achieve a greater visual intensity. So if it is adjacent tonalities, that will be less intense, and that is affinity. So this is, it can be in tonality, in color, like red and green here is in color wise contrast. So color in terms of color, tonality, movements, in lines, in shapes, in many ways, this tonal contrast, this contrast, idea of contrast and affinity can play. And that is a long learning process, journey, which you will have to take your own hand. And probably this book, which based on which I am created this presentation, is The Visual Story by Bruce Block. The PDF is available in the net, and all of you can read it and study it deeply. That will create a kind of better understanding. So this is something which I will talk, and like color, if you take in terms of color, it is more of affinity. It is a kind of pink and red and together, it is like that. But any color image will have tonality in it. And that is something which any visual artist has to learn to perceive. Because we generally see only the color image, and the tonality, tonal contrast in is something very deeper, potential thing, something which we can use, that should be studied by the thing. So it is like this, it is difference of tone, that is black and white, and it is an extreme situation, kind of a silhouette figure where the background is light and the character standing totally against it. It's extreme intensity. But this is a still from Kahini. So something like that, which is translated in visual terms in a film practiced, it will be like this. Or you can say this is affinity. You hardly can see the person standing there. And here also. So this is more of affinity of tones, both the instances. And if you see another image, it's a interesting photograph of a play of contrast and affinity. An image with extreme contrast and a painting. Obviously, he is known for it, Caravaggio. So, and another still from a film where tonal is arrangement is of affinity. No, you must remember that you know it is not in one to one black and white relationship. No, affinity, contrast, and all will there will be a corner in a frame which is affinity, but some the opposite corner will have contrast, or short to short it will change. Maybe the idea of contrast and affinity may change when you pan the camera across the room. All that happens. So and all the elements, like what you said, tonality, line, shape, color, movement, all that is coming together, existing at the same time within a frame. So it is a complex signal which is created by the director and transferred to the audience. So it is not that easy. Another idea of an empty space which is uniquely of without any matter, without anything in it. So it is an absent frame, actually. There is probably what you can do is to put a point. The basic image you can create, there is a point, and that is what we have today, pixels. And it can become complex in terms of any of the elements we were discussed, lines, shapes. In shape, there is circles and triangles, inside rectangles, or very complex things can be created. This is two frames from Piravi. This is a simple closer frame, and where the shapes and the the shape of the collar all kind of echoes these curves. So there is a lot of the idea of more of affinity in terms of tonality also. But here you can see a lot of contrasting elements, light, dark, diagonals, opposing diagonals, verticals. So it is a little more complex time. And this is a sequence where the father comes out of the police IG's office, and he is mentally troubled, and that is created with this step sequence where he is coming down the step and other police officers are moving up. And the sound is also created in a kind of a contrasting manner. So that is one sequence I like visually. It tells the story visually. So if you look at these two images, you can see in terms of light, there is a lot of affinity here. The way it is falling, mild, soft, gently, kind of wrapping around the characters. And here it is not like that. It is more of extreme, bright thing and darkness created by the lamp itself, and that creates a lot of drama and tension. This is from Train to Pakistan, these two stills. And so this is another idea of idea in light, affinity and contrast. as an element of light itself. And of course, you know, in the extreme case is like white and black. If I make a film with white frames alternating with black, there will be a high intensity of flicker, and probably some people will be triggered of epileptic attack because of the flicker intensity. By the way, there is a film called The Flicker also. That is a nice experiment one filmmaker did. He called the famous critics and filmmakers to a theater and said, 11 o'clock, there is a screening of my film, 10 minutes long, and it is called Flicker. So what he did is, he asked the projectionist to run the projector at 11 o'clock without any film. So for 10 minutes, he ran the projector, and that projector was creating a flicker in the, because of the shutter, it will create a flicker on the screen. And after watching 1 minute, 2 minutes, people will start seeing colors and different things on the screen, no? by induced by their brain reactions. And then 11:10, he stopped it. So that is a film which is recorded, but without a film. It is called Flicker. Such experiments people used to do. And of course, those are the early days of cinema. And anyway, let us come back. So this will be extreme intensity, and it may even trigger epileptic attack. But suppose you have only shots which is grays. If you project this one after another, you will not notice even the shot change, because it is all the same. And you will not even see the change of shots. You know, it will be uniform. It will be without any conflict and without any intensity. It will be just one dragging, motionless, movement. So,
I have a request. As we are, as I was talking to you yesterday, you said that in the context of affinity and contrast, you'd like to show us a sequence from the battleship.
Probably from Goya.
Probably from Goya, then it's fine.
Let me try and screen the opening sequence from Goya. Let me see if it is possible. Is it being screened? Anirban, is it playing?
Yes, sir.
Okay. We'll just see the this title sequence. We'll just see.
Okay,
sequence.
donde estoy.
Back to that is a few minutes of wonderful filmmaking, and if you know, one has to look into all these elements which we were discussing of line, color, light, the principles of affinity and contrast. The way it is slowly built up from the ground. There, no, and coming through the symbol ropes, it no, it is symbol lines first, and then the texture of the sand or the ground which is there. But then suddenly color comes in, and that color then predominantly moves with the his interior of his house and all that, and he is waking up from sleep and asking this question, where am I? No, he's not recognizing his surroundings, and he's walking out into the street, and that is the sequence. So in between, he comes and with his fingers draws the spiral, and he says the spiral, which is a motif throughout the film. And when the film ends also, there is this staircases which moves like a spiral. And there are, you will see the reference to spiral many times in the thing. So, but if I look at the stills, let me just quickly go through that. You can see that these frames, gradually becoming complex. It starts from darkness and slowly moving in with little recognizable things and colors, and comes to the the body of the buffalo, and then move through the head of it, and then slowly complexity of shape, lines and shapes comes, and it is contrasting with I'm just going through this. And as you move in, there's a morphing of his Goya space coming out of, emerging out of that, body, flesh of the animal. And that is like it is like giving birth. It's death as well as idea of birth. So, and ends up with the extreme contrast image of this face. Contrast in the sense of light, but you can see this tonality, light and shadow, but in color it is a monochromatic effect, which when you come to the wider shot, again light is contrast, but in terms of color you can see it is a single red monochromatic affinity in terms of color, but in terms of light it is extreme contrast. And that this play of light and contrast in terms of color and creating perspective and a frontal plane, that goes on through the sequences. As and when the director needs that intensity, he builds these images and lighting through lighting. This is when you come outside of the house and see through the misty window pane, it is affinity more of shapes, tonalities and everything. Starts writing that, and when we comes inside, we now clearly see the spiral and the contrasty lighting, and things are more evident. Once he moves out, the other color, extreme contrast of colors starts coming into play. Red and blue, which is alternating within the shot, and almost goes off, and it merges with the background. Then the other side also is like that. A great play of light, intercut between these things, which creates a lot of intensity, emotional intensity in the scene. And then suddenly this figure starts moving across the frame. That is also a great moment of intensity because of the movement. And our protagonist also start walking, because once he start walking and go through the other room, suddenly again we have ideas in terms of color and lighting, more of affinity. But as it tracks, so I am saying that it is not very one-to-one equation. It is a complex arrangement and play of things, which makes us see it again and again, you know. And when it comes out, then there is a, you know, in terms of spatial arrangement, there is a lot of, perspective is created. You know, in terms of space, there is one thing which
I'm just cutting in. If you tell us a little about the four types of spaces, I think that would be really useful to our students.
Yeah, so this is, there are only four ways of arranging space in a film. That is deep space, which you see here, creating by the longitudinal lines, diagonal, this creating this perspective. And then frontal plane and flat space. This is a flat space. This is deep space. And then there are limited space there, where you avoid the longitudinal plane. Only foreground, midground, background will be there. This is an arrangement you see later films of Ingmar Bergman. Limited space and ambiguous space. Ambiguous space is something which is used in thrillers and suspense films and all. You don't know the spatial relationship and the size relationship unless there is a movement, camera movement or a character movement. You don't know the real volume or the about the shape of the things around that character. So that kind of a ambiguous space is the fourth type. So
I think in Citizen Kane they used the ambiguous space beautifully in more than one sequence. Especially one sequence is coming to my mind where Kane's company is gone, he's bankrupt after the 1929 crash.
Yeah.
Immediately after that scene, that his guardian is trying to buy that company out to save Kane. It's very the ambiguous space is very used in a very interesting way.
Yeah, as we saw in this sequence itself, these are coming, within a scene, you will have one shot in flat space, one shot in deep space, next shot in. So in terms of editing also, this works, affinity and contrast. If you put together two shots which are flat space only, then it is affinity. You put one flat space, next deep space, then it is contrast in terms of cutting. So in different ways, this multiple ideas work.
So just one question, sir. So a small question, sir.
Yeah.
So when you talked about this limited space, just one film came to my mind, that is In the Mood for Love.
Exactly. Yeah. That was also coming to my mind.
Where is that limited space?
Yes, it is. That is very much the limited space only.
And also the last scene in Godfather.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, see this, they will have background, foreground, middle ground and all, but there won't be any longitudinal plane. So that is the difference in limited space. And see, this is from Manikaul's one film. So you can say it is, in a way, it is a flat space by the arrangement, but there is an element of longitudinal thing in this, inside this door. So, and if I cut this frame line this way, in this angle, then it becomes much more flatter. So there is a degree of these ideas also. It's not just totally. Otherwise, it should be a simple wall. A camera looking at a wall can be extreme flat space. But our situations are not always like that. Or looking into a railway track, the camera looking into a railway track is a string case of perspective. So that is not the case always. And sometimes these are visible, sometimes it is invisible also. So in case of rooms and all, the the perspective lines are not clearly visible. This is Osu. I was talking about earlier rearranges things so that everything comes as one. And look at this, everything has equal importance. Even his lamp or this box here or this here, everything. It's a perfect balance.
So in a way, I also already posed this question to you. In a way, Ozu's handling of space and the characters inside that space in some way philosophically goes against the classical Hollywood's idea of making one person important, the idea of power hierarchy.
Yeah. That is evident. That is obvious. And that is even in terms of stories, they were Superman and Spider-Man and Batman and all. They are one against all, But Eastern stories, it is not like that. So even, a kind of high angle view will give you, it will take off that perspective lines. And of course, this is a limited space, but very interesting. That's what I said. In this window creates a lot of longitudinal lines and it is a projection into it. But then as a whole, this is coming more to a flat space. So, and if you...
I mean, I always feel the idea of using limited space is where the characters are limited. They can't move freely. They are somehow restricted to their space. That's where this kind of space is, should be used.
No, but then there may be very big drama happening within that. And also use of lensing and all that create a certain kind of compressed idea of space, which like Chrysler whispers this face or this image.
Yeah, I mean, by restricted to someone's space means not only physical space, can be mental space also, like in The Mood for Love. They're restricted in their own.
But there is a fluidity and a lot of freedom in The Mood for Love. Within their existence.
That is there, but finally they are restricted. Finally, they can't really cross the barrier.
Yeah, that is there.
So one small question, sir. I don't know whether, I hope I'm not going too out of context, since we are discussing, sir, you are discussing so much about space. I just wanted to know, the films that you have shot, how much have you intervened into the production design aspect? Like, since we are talking so much about space and I was just curious, like, how much have you intervened with the production design, or like, what has been your role?
Many of these ideas I learned myself after doing 20 or 30 films. So you get a very limited time to do this, but in a way, within my own experience, I think a director who is extremely concerned about the arrangement of space is Buddhadev Das Gupta. Dada, really works with the space in a very beautiful way. And that is why his films look very unique, none like any other film. So his idea of arranging and cheating sometimes, the very beautiful way of, twisting the space and making it look like something else. They are all very well, he spent a lot of time also deciding that, and that sometimes takes a lot of time. But that's why his first line to me when I talked to him to become a cinematographer with him, he said that, "Sunny, I don't prepare, meaning I don't give you a shooting script before the shoot. We come to the set and then we will experiment and decide the way how it should be taken." So in a way, that is very, kind of free, kind of there is a freedom. And in terms of time, it takes a lot, it is expensive. But if you have that freedom, that is one way of doing it. And like director like Adur sir, Adur Gobalakrishnan, probably would have all his frames, shots predetermined, and you know, he moves with that. So that is a different way of working. And in another Aravindetan, G. Aravindan would be completely free. He comes to the set, and and nature also works with him in many ways. And in terms of his landscapes and all, there could be spontaneous things. But let me tell you one story of the maximum time I took composing a shot in Vastuhara, the film which I worked with him, is of a banyan tree. In front of the small temple, there is a banyan tree, and we took almost 1 hour to compose that frame. And when you see that shot, actually, then there is a kind of elevating experience. And in fact, when I was screening the film for Christophe Sanussi, and when this shot came, he moved forward saying, ah, not like that, but that was expression. So it affects, that frame affects people. And in a way, every framing will affect people, the way you, put forward things. So, but I cannot say that I have worked, one of the film where I think I worked very much in the designing was Venus Daya. That film, of course, I worked with the art director and Venu, and in terms of its color palettes, its the way it should be shot and all that, there was a lot of discussion. And when we were in Jaisalmer, Venu's primary instruction to me was that none of the shot none of it should look like a calendar shot. No, it shouldn't be. So I think that I succeeded in it, except one shot. It looked a calendar shot. It was with a sunset. You cannot avoid such occurrences.
Yeah, this leads to a logical question. Talking about collaboration between director and cinematographer, you beautifully explained that it changes from time to time. It depends on their personalities and the film in question. You have worked with cinematographer stunt directors like Shaji and Karun, Venu, or production designer turned director like Malay Bhattacharya. So how was your experience in collaborating with them? And also, I would like in this context, like to ask you, who owns the image? How do you negotiate the ownership of the image?
I have been one of the signatories of the ownership and authorship rights of cinematographers in Torun. When it has been declared that cinematographer is also the author of the image in a film. But it is in India, there only producer has authorship rights, and not even the director. So anyway, for me, like I said earlier, the image which is created is a contribution of many people, starting from the designer, the art director, costumer, makeup man, cinematographer. And the most important element of his authorship is lighting, and how he creates the tonalities and lighting, and how he imparts the movement of the camera. And in terms of composition, that is how much volume the character is seen and the environment is seen, is actually part of the mise-en-scene, which ideally should be decided by the director. So lighting is the essential authorship tool of cinematographer, and through the lighting only we can identify the style and kind of approaches. And basically, when you talk about lighting also, there are only two types of methodology. One is the pictorial lighting methods, and then there is the motivated lighting, motivated, realistic. following a source light. Like in this image, Zwenikist is following the sources, the windows, and lighting accordingly. So this is a motivated lighting scheme. And any kind of mainstream cinema where there is songs and dance, and there is no such logic. You make the image very beautiful. That is the only criteria. So that becomes pictorial lighting. That both has its value in its cinemas. And incidentally, I would like to talk about Subrata Dada at this time. Because Dada was my mentor, and I have been very fortunate enough to spend a lot of time. I never assisted him in any film, but I was fortunate enough to be with him. And it is Dada who actually created today's mainstream practice of soft lighting and bounce lighting. And he is also credited as the inventor of soft boxes. So we all forget about that, and this is the predominant way people light a scene today, and that is a widely accepted factor also. So thanks to Dada, and thanks to Satyajit Ray also, because his insistence that he was bounce lighting and the sets in Calcutta were small. And then he gave an ultimatum to Subrata Dada, saying that you change your lighting or create something. So that is how he invented the soft box. So that is why he also deserves our thanks.
Subrata Mitra gifted his light meter to you, right?
No, not gifted. He tried to give his reflected light meter. Once he asked, after seeing Piravi, Dada asked me what reflected light meter you are using. So I told him that I don't use any reflected light meter. Then he shouted at me, what kind of a cinematographer are you if you don't have a reflected light meter? So then I said, Dada, I don't have money. Then he took his analog, Pentax analog reflected light meter and gave it to me. And I thought, oh, that is the luckiest thing to happen. But then I took it and I was leaving. Obviously, this was an old meter and it takes some time to read. You know, the needle will slowly move and come to position. So I, while I was leaving, he called me back and said, no, you don't take it. You will spend a lot of time using it in set, and your directors will get angry. Your producers will get angry. He knew that Malayalam cinema, Malayalam films, and the films which I work kind of get finished in 20 days, 25 days. So this will probably hinder me. So he said, don't take it. But then he said, you buy one digital reflected light meter and then come back to me, stay with me for a week, and I will teach you the sound system. But then I couldn't buy one for many years, and then unfortunately I got my first meter only after Subrata Dada passed away. The next day after Subrata Dada passed away, I got my reflected light meter, and I took it on myself that I should thoroughly learn the sound system. So I then myself studied. Of course, Dada had taught us long back in our FTA days. And then I started practicing it consciously. So that is how later, I am pretty okay with the sound system practiced in lighting. So obviously, there are plus points to it, and the way we pre-visualize, it is a good tool to decide on how our tonalities should be placed. So
we are at the fag end of our webinar. You are showing us something. Please go on.
No, I just thought of just...
Shobhoshachi, if you have any question, specific question related to Piravi or Kahidi, please.
So I'm just showing some of the frames from Osu. Again, you can see this idea, no? Throughout his compositions. I am fascinated with Osu's composition.
So are you trying to take it up in your work? As you are fascinated, you must be required to use such things.
I am talking to others and inspiring them to do something like this. And also, strangely, somebody who would very bravely for picture the artist from behind, you know, and with very emotional scenes like that. Very, very.
We would love to see at least a sequence from your own work, anything of your choice. And if you talk about
that, I'll show and then questions can be there. Let me just try to show the ending of Kahini.
Okay.
Let me just try to pick it. So I'm stopping this. Can you see the?
Yeah, I can see.
Yes, sir. Yes, yes. You can see.
Wait, I have to do it again.
Ochina, shobi oi charkona kagoje bondi. কে যেন সেই বলেছিল স্মৃতি যেন বাতিল হয়ে যাওয়া ঘোড়া দায় নেই দায়িত্ব নেই দানা পানি জুটে যায় বেঁচে করতে থাকে ইদানিং তাই মনে হয় কতগুলো স্থির মুহূর্তকে পরপর জুড়ে জুড়েই হয়তো একটা গোটা অথবা সবকিছুই অর্থহীন আর তাকে অর্থপূর্ণ করে তোলার মধ্যেই না
Thank you. Oh.
Yes, sir. Small question, sir. Since sir, Maulana has been a teacher of mine, and we have discussed a lot about Kahini. So just since we were like, Anirvan was asking about this collaborative thing. So just curious to know a little bit about the, you know, the collaboration between you and Maulana when Kahini happened. Just maybe in brief, you can, if you can talk.
Actually, this film took more than 1.5 years to finish in 2-3 schedule. So it was, but you know, we were able to get that you know, idea, you know, to hold on to the things, and it's you know, so we had, you know, Malaida being a designer, graphic designer, he had some kind of you know, storyboard to work with. So this is one film where I worked with the storyboard, and then another film we had to throw away the storyboard was Train to Pakistan, because that was all opposite to the existing place, you know, the directions given in the storyboard was opposite. So but Malaida's this we had a long discussions, and I was staying in Malaida's house also while during the shooting or preparation time. So we had a lot of time to interact and discuss things. So in that way, this was very you know, fulfilling and collaborative work. And that it shows in that, in the film. And if you notice, you know, none of my films have similar compositional or kind of the idea of composition is constantly changing, because I go with the director and the script, and I don't perceive beforehand that I will only use this and that and make every film like looking pictorially the same way, and that is not an idea, good idea for a cinematographer. And in terms of lighting, of course, I am a diehard fan of motivated lighting, and where I could, wherever that is asked for, I go for it. And natural, I tend to use natural light, wherever available natural light, and embellish that, and you add to that lighting. That is something which even earlier great Italian cinematographers tried to do. So I kind of follow that, and I can also say that if you talk about the gharana of cinematography of Subrata Mitra, then I can say I belong to that gharana. And there was a memorial retrospective which some Italian film people done in Italy a few years ago. And actually they called me and asked me to show Piravi, as one of the retrospective had four of Dada's film and Piravi as the following, as a following gharana kind of a thing. So I couldn't go there, but I recorded my message and sent them, and they showed, projected it before the retrospective started. So that was a nice experience. My light has battery has gone down.
We can see a change in color. We can open the room to direct questions from students.
Yes, yeah. Because you know, I am sure that these are all limited time, and once you get into details of things, and there's no end. It is inspire and for the youngsters to look further forward, and you have to learn. That is a lifelong process, and then that is why we all need to, filmmakers and film cinematographers. Sometimes people ask me, from Kerala, why so many at one point of time in all Chennai, Mumbai, and Calcutta, all Mallu cameramans were moving in and out. So somebody asked me, why is it so? So I said, probably all of us, we cinematographers are voracious readers. We read a lot of literature, other books, and interested generally in the life around us. So that is probably one reason we are being called to many places. And this is something I advise to youngsters also. You should pick up, if you don't have the habit, you should read more, see more films, listen to more music, see plays, visit places, visit museums, see other artworks. Because all this is your data collection. And when you have to make a decision on what frame, what kind of balancing you have to do with the image, then that decision actually happens organically. We are not standing there and discussing things like is it in rule of thirds, is it following the rule of third, or things like that. No, it is an organic decision which happens with the moment of the shooting. So to get to there, you need these data. And like a supercomputer, you will function efficiently if you have maximum data with you. So that is, and then to recognize emotion. How do you, when a scene is enacted in front of you, how will you understand that it is emotionally sounding true? So you should understand those things. We cannot experience all of the, emotion by ourselves. But so that's, we, go through these books and all, and also we assimilate those kind of experiences through other authors. Yes,
okay,
sir.
Any question from students? You can unmute your mic and ask.
One by one.
One by one, yeah.
I have a question, sir.
Yes.
Sir, I am Shartak Dasharma, a student of film and television production. So my question to you is, you were talking about the concept of Saba, the Japanese concept of Saba. How the what we call in Bengali is Shomoyer Chap.
Imprint of time.
Yeah, imprint of time. So one director that obviously comes in mind after listening imprint of time is Andrei Tarkovsky.
Obviously.
And I want to ask is, what I want to ask is, who should look after this? The director, the cinematographer, or the production designer of the film, to capture that essence of time.
That is it is a very important question, in the sense that is what makes a film unique. And obviously, Tarkovsky is in my mind when I am talking about it. He was my most favorite director while I was studying. And even after leaving the institute, I wanted to join him as an assistant. And through Aravind, I was trying to get into his unit to learn with him. But then, unfortunately, he passed away. And this imprint of time, in the sense that it need not be looked at as everything old and wrinkles and all that. No. But that's why I said the time, Tarkovsky talks about sculpting in time. Cinema is an art of sculpting in time. Then we should now move into the idea of time. And there is a lot of philosophical ramification because the cinema also exists in an experience of linear time. We start the screening at say 6 o'clock and end at 8:30. But in a way, there is this linear connection in cinema. We can also experience all these things together, past, present, and future. That in a you know, experiential way, we can only have that experience in cinema, not in our real life. So once I witnessed a lecture by a Schrodinger Memorial Lecture organized by Austrian Embassy, and the talk was given by the great George Sudarshan. So lecture was, does time move forward? So it was a 4-hour scientific lecture, and I attended it, you know. Just I was wondering, I was always fascinated with the idea of time. What he stopped was saying that time does not have an arrow of direction. So it is an eternal now. And so when you consider time, and modern physicists also are saying that time is, you know, the past, present and future are all existing at the same plane. And then it is very interesting, and we don't know actually. And in our philosophy, Indian philosophy, it is said that the greatest disease of mind is to see time past, present and future. So if you overcome that, you will be at peace. So it is very difficult for us. I see my hair getting more and more gray. But coming back to your question, yes, it is a collaborative art, and cinema, when it comes to screen, everything matters. Each contribution, like if you look at the making of Tarkovsky's own The Sacrifice, last film, we have the, you know, documentary of that shooting, that last sequence. So the first time it all went wrong, you know, it was not working at all. And the second time when they shot, rebuilt the house, and then with the two cameras he was shooting it, and the camera is moving here, you know, across the scene. And when finally, when it comes to back to the house with the wife kneeling down in front of the house, you see that, you know, that the correct moment the building collapses. No, it is not, you know, pre-planned. You know, sometimes things like that happens. That is the beauty of it, you know. So who is responsible for that exact moment of the building falling? You know, that neither Swenikist or Tarkovsky can take the credit for it. So if you look like that, you know, sometimes I shoot with Aravindan, and I have always experienced that wherever he is shooting, the nature kind of collaborates with him and gives him very wonderful kind of things. And who will take the credit for that? You know, when you get a beautiful sunset or a sky, whose credit is that? So these things, eventually what we can say is a collaborative art. And when 10 people, 100 people think together and work together, yes, magic happens. And obviously the textural quality of it, and that is determined by the expertise of the cinematographer. And that credit goes to cinematographer. And the way it is choreographed, and the whole movement occurring in front of camera, of characters, of things, that credit goes to the director. So then the total, if there is nothing in front of the camera, we cannot create any magic like that. So you need the artwork people, the carpenter, the painter, the machine work, or a costumer, tailor, everybody is contributing. So I would say that way it is, we should be thankful to all of them. But I can say that the textural quality of the image eventually is depending on the lighting and exposure. So that credit goes to cinematographer.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Any other Thanks. Question from anyone else?
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
I had a question. As you were talking about Ozu for quite a long time, I wanted to ask, like, in Ozu's films, most of the characters, or in Oriental films, if we call of East, most of the characters play a big role in carrying forward the narrative. Yeah. Right. So, how does Ozu or any other director who comes to your mind takes all the characters, all the people in a movie and uses its framing, narrative devices and other devices to carry forward the narrative and make the viewers or the audience get emotionally connected with the characters or main protagonists?
That is, again, a question which can be discussed for many hours. This is how. No, let us be clear about one factor, that most of the stories we tell today is about human beings, very rarely about a fish or a elephant, or some stories are also there, but mostly about human beings and their conflicts. And that is basically portrayed by, etched by the actors. So one of the main element of the narrative today, that is this kind of the main storytelling films, kind of films, it is obviously, actors. So it is natural that actors take the foreground in terms of unfolding the story. And there are, take a film like I was referring to Passion of Joan of Arc earlier. Take that film. We cannot imagine, Passion of Joan of Arc without Falconetti. And that was her only film. He only acted in one film and that is it. So, but the way the faces being composed, the relationship between the characters, which is within the frame, how it is related, all this also helps to tell that story. But your question is how a director uses actors to emotionally connect with the audience. Is that the question?
Sir, my actual question is in Ozu's films, not only one person gets the main protagonist, the name of the protagonist, right? Each and everyone plays an equal or more or less equal part in the cinema, like Tokyo Story, Noriko trilogies, all of these films. So how does a director deal with these kind of situations, or a cinematographer actually deals with this kind of situations where each and every person has a main role to play?
So this is, that comes in within the script. Isn't it? So, we are, as cinematographers, I am not taking up the role of the director. That is the realm of the director, where he is, the way he equally distributes his narrative between 10 characters or 2 characters. That is the directorial element. As a cinematographer, I was showing you many of Ozu frames, where you will see that his compositions equally tells the same philosophy, that within the frame, even within one frame, every object and every character has equal importance. And that is a philosophical outlook on the world. And that that is inside of Ozu. And that to how we visually kind of represent that is a kind of probably getting acquainted with his philosophy, and then understand. See, even when I look at Ozu's films after so many years, 83 I graduated from Pune, and the last probably 2 years ago only I was looking at Ozu's composition in such a way. That this is what he's doing. Sometimes he's taught it is the Japanese culture. People sit and interact. That's why the camera is lower. Or he's a lazy director. He's sitting all the time. So mostly alluded to Japanese cultural interaction in society. That is why the lower camera. But I see a consistent use of the elevation of the camera at a particular, it is changing. It is not that it is at 2 feet, every shot is 2 feet height. No. So according to the compositional the necessity, he to bring it all in the frontal plane and parallel, he changes it probably. We can, you know, I haven't gone extremely deeper into its structuring. That needs a lot of time to study. But basically, I would say that that part of the using character means characters in such a way, the narrative distributed through many or single character, all that the director is the author, and you know, I cannot take much credit for that. And see, we are involved in you know, this characterization and all, in a sense that many a times the directors will call us for audition. We are also sitting there, and we have read the script, and we have created a mental image of the you know, characters. So like in Nizhal Kutta, when the you know, that younger characters, when Adur was selecting the characters, he called me also, and he said, sit and give me your opinion on these you know, actors. So I used to you know, tell him that this character in a proper, in this way it looks suitable, or in some other way it is not looking suitable. So we are getting involved in some films like that, but not all films. So like I said earlier, it is a complex process by however more interactions and more you know, exchanges of ideas occur in a film, that much it helps to define the final product. So you cannot join a film and not to talk to the director and expect something good come out of it. No, you need constant communication. And see, after all, you know, the final story vision is with the director. You know, I am you know, in between for a month or 2 months, I join a director and then help him. My ultimate responsibility in terms of helping his vision to be actualized on screen in terms of the pictorial elements, like what we were discussing, the lines, tones, colors, all that. And well, I don't think I have probably anything more to say on that.
Yeah, I think that's a satisfactory answer. Anyone else? Actually, cross the 2 hour mark. That's okay. Yes. Anyone? Yeah. Anyone else has any question? So can address that.
Sir, once again, I want to ask a question. It's just a request to you. It is just as you were talking about lights, lines, geometry, shapes. Sir, can you just give examples of 2-3 directors whom you find the most fascinating or radical use of lines and shapes and lights, colors?
Of course, you know, I, the very first instant the feeling comes to my mind is Cries and Whispers. Ingmar Bergman, or even Goya, which I screened. Sven Nykvist and Vittorio Storaro, these are two great cinematographers who were consciously working on these concepts. And you can look into, Vittorio Storaro's writing, and he would directly you can read it. And of course, his books are very expensive as himself. It is some 75,000 rupees for his book. I haven't read it, but I know that it has been talked in that book. But his lectures, many of it is available in internet. And see, like a simple idea of, have you seen the film Cries and Whispers?
Yes, sir.
Gosh. So what do you think, why the color red?
Sir, Sir, it's better you answer.
No, no, no. What do you know about it or what you thought about it? I will tell you a story. That is why.
It was very hard for me to perceive.
Why?
Sir, it just went out of my head. I couldn't just understand what the director was trying to actually say or actually get through the audience.
About the film?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
I watched it 2-3 times, but it was actually getting out of me. That's why I asked you.
How old are you?
Sir, I'm just 18 right now.
Okay. So, I saw first Bergman film as around your age only. So, that was not, you know, Wild Strawberries. And it you know, kind of shook me you know, deeply. Because it was, you know, when you see that old man entering into his past and you know, be with those characters and all that, and you know, I myself is intrigued by the temporal aspect, so I was very excited to see such a film at that time. Then Cries and Whispers, you know, why I asked, you know, the critics have written you know, lot of things about why Bergman used red as a theme in Cries and Whispers, because it is talking about death, because it is talking about disease. So, like that. But in 1983 or 84, Bombay IFFI, the film International Film Festival, there was a retrospective of Ingmar Bergman. And Ingmar Bergman was not attending. He was not traveling. Erland Josephson, his you know, main actor in Cries and Whispers, he was attending. And Subrata Dada was also in the crowd. I was sitting behind Subrata Dada and Erland Josephson. As the film started, this is, you must remember, this was after 25 years of making it. Erland Josephson suddenly started, got up and saying something in his language, walking out. And Subrata Mitra is also following Erland Josephson. So Erland Josephson was asking, where is the projection room? Where is the projection room? So he was running to the projection room. Since Subrata Dada was also going, I also followed. So Erland Josephson went to projectionist and shouted at him, "Hey, why the color is like that?" You know, it was a dupe print from National Film Archives, and it was a muddy orange instead of the pure red grades shades. We have red shades in the film, and Erland Josephson was asking, "Where is the red? Where is the red?" So he says it was an important decision for Bergman to keep that red. So then Dada asked him, "Why? What is that secret? Why it is red?" So he said, Bergman conceived this film happening within the four chambers of the heart. That is why he created this red color in the walls. So this is something which is in the mind of the author, you know. It may, need not be very evidently comprehensible for the viewer, but that red, of course, affects you. And then in terms of the pain and the you know, the relationship which is they try to connect between the sisters and the Aya, and there is a broken promise of probably they will understand each other, but that doesn't happen. And the futility of, you know, Bergman's questions are always about why this life, why we are here, and, you know, is there a God out there who is controlling all this? You know, such philosophical questions are interested to him. And he is trying to talk. And if I, you know, see the three all the actors in Cries and Whispers, you won't see better performance than those you know, actresses. And like whether it is Liv Ullmann, Harriet Anderson, or Ingrid Thulin, all of them, you know, fabulous actors. And you know, even I sometimes I screen the first 10 minutes of Cries and Whispers to tell students how visually you should tell stories. The first 10 minutes, there is no dialogue. We are only watching these 3-4 characters. And by that 10 minutes, you will understand everything, their character traits, their emotional condition, all that you will understand without a word. You know, the elder sister, how stern she is, the younger sister, how you know, self-centered or how sensuous and playfully looking at the life in a very sensuous way. All that is seen through visuals, and nobody talks anything about. If you remember that Prakash, the very first time, you know, the Aya comes and wakes her up, younger sister, and gives the tea. How will a Hindi film or a Malayalam film have? There will be one dialogue saying the Aya will tell to the sleeping character that Neram Velutu, Chai Gudichate. So, you know, it is you know, get a morning and have the tea. So you don't have to say that in dialogue. So it is sometimes we forget that there are a lot of things can be shown in visual alone, and you don't need. I remember once I was attending a seminar where Jean-Claude Carrier, the famous French scriptwriter, you know, who wrote Mahabharata and all, and he had come, and there are 200 students asking a question, how to write good script. So he said, there is no easy way. First thing you have to do is write your first draft of your script without dialogue. Tell the story without any dialogue. That is the only way to write a good script. And if you are not succeeding to tell your full story without dialogue, then add wherever you are finding a difficulty, then there only you add dialogue. If you write scripts like that, then you are writing a good script for a film. So that is what his advice was. And I thought that it is very, very, very valid.
I don't think so. In any case, we have run out of time. Long back. We are in extended time. So, thank you, Sunny sir, for joining us for a webinar spanning almost 2 hours and a half. And we are holding these webinars with eminent personalities from the industry, the professionals, so that the students become familiar to them. And when we call you, the experts, for workshop here, then students won't have the primary hesitation. They would be able to gel in, and they would be able to use the time in the best possible way. So we hope to see you for such a workshop.
Thank you, sir. It was such a lovely experience, enriching, enthralling.
So I only hope that I had more time to show more things.
Yes,
you know?
By talking,
it is not enough. But, you know, that is the limitation of the online thing. Otherwise, it is also good in a sense that wherever students are sitting, they are concentrating and they are listening with the correct attention. So, and that is a good part of it. Anyway, I wish you all the best. And yes, probably see you all in person in near future. And ta-ta.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.